The story of Sammy Lee and his love for America begins on the streets of Seoul, South Korea. Sammy's Korean parents were contractually obligated to marry each other by their parents before either one was born. They moved to the U.S. and Sammy was born in Fresno in 1920. And when he was five, his parents opened a grocery store in Highland Park. The neighbors complained that they didn't want any, in Sammy's words, chinks or Japs living in their neighborhood. The landlord was a German immigrant who told them, "Someday you'll brag that they were your neighbors." When the games of 1932 took place in Los Angeles, the 12-year-old Sammy saw the banners and flags and was inspired to learn how to do his first somersault in the Highland Park pool, thanks to the coaching of a black American named Hart Crum. "I told Papa that someday I would be an Olympic diving champ." Papa said, "But you must also be a doctor of medicine." And I promised I would. In spite of his choice of sport and his stature, 5'1", Sammy found a way to excel. He was the student body president at Franklin High School. Some remarkable classmates, some are here today. He later attended Occidental College on a scholarship. And by 1942, Sammy became the national diving champion on platform and springboard. But the 1940 and 44 Olympic Games had been canceled because of World War II. He likely would have won medals. Though the racism and prejudice of the day were more than inconvenient, to say the least, Sammy never carried a grudge and was always grateful to have been raised in the United States. He earned his medical degree at USC, thanks to the U.S. Army Reserve funding. He received his doctorate of medicine diploma from the Keck School of Medicine in 1947, and he proudly wore the cardinal and gold for the rest of his life. In 1948, at the Olympic Games in London, after winning a bronze on the springboard, he earned the gold medal on platform with an unprecedented 3.5 somersault dive. He had just become the first Asian American male to win an Olympic gold medal. At a subsequent diving exhibition at the Taylor Pool in Occidental College, Sammy met Rosalind Wong, and the two quickly became one. "I've never met a better matched pair of sweethearts." They went everywhere together, and to this day, the Olympic family considers Roz as an Olympian, too. 4 years after London, he was prepared to forego the next Olympic Games to serve his country in the Korean conflict. But his superiors said, "We've got hundreds of doctors who can repair the wounded. We've only got one doctor who can win the Olympic gold." Before he even earned his place on that year's Olympic team, Roz purchased a ticket and boarded the boat headed for Helsinki, Finland. At the Helsinki Games in 1952, on his 32nd birthday, Sammy became the first Olympian to successfully defend an Olympic diving title, and Roz was there. Because of his friendly and funny nature, Sammy was universally adored, even by his opponents. The following year, while on a tour of duty in South Korea, he was awarded the James E. Sullivan Award as the nation's outstanding amateur athlete in all sports. With his life partner at his side, Sammy retired from competition and began making a name for himself as a top ear, nose, and throat doctor, but he continued to walk the pool deck as a coach. He developed many great diving champions, including Bob Webster, the second man to successfully defend an Olympic diving title, and of course the greatest female and male divers of all time, Patty McCormick and Greg Louganis. 9 Olympic medals between them. He coached the U.S. Olympic team in 1960 and the Japanese and Korean delegations in 1964. He never asked to be paid for his coaching because, as he said, "My coaches never charged me." He remained a diving judge and official for the rest of his life. He volunteered to serve on President Council of Physical Fitness under Chairman Arnold Schwarzenegger, where Sammy repeatedly claimed to be Arnold's low-blow bodyguard. In 1984, we were both honored to escort the big white Olympic flag into the opening ceremony of the 84 Games in Los Angeles. Here also, Pat McCormick was honored, and Wyoming Attias was honored, and Al Order, whose widow Kathy is here, was also honored. I was tasked with the guy in the right corner to yell out the marching cadence. Left, 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 right, left. I could hear Sammy behind me yelling, "Shorter steps, you bastard." Sammy was inducted into the USC Sports Hall of Fame, the International Swimming Hall of Fame, the US Olympic Hall of Fame. He has an LAUSD school and street corner in Koreatown named after him, as well as a star on the Anaheim Orange County Walk of Fame. Here on the USC campus, the Olympic Diving Tower also bears his name. I cannot recall Sammy without recalling his wonderful smile and his quick and often salty sense of humor. His greatest joy seemed to be making other people happy. Sammy may have been small in stature, but he leaves behind a huge legacy of how an individual with charm and love and joy can accomplish his dreams and can help change the world for the better. He also leaves behind his loving and adorable wife, Roz, his daughter, Pamela, and son, Sam, and three marvelous grandchildren. We'll hear from them shortly. If Sammy was here, I think he'd want me to end on the advice his father once gave him that Sammy later repeated, and I quote, "Papa told me something that never, ever left my heart. You are born a free American, and it's your God-given right to throw your ancestral roots into this boiling pot of American freedom and become the best you can be. In the USA, there is no impossible dream."
Like no other sport, diving captures the journey of life. Similar to a diver, we begin on a precipice, summoning will and fortitude to leap into the unknown, harnessing strength and agility to defy forces arrayed in opposition, engaging mind and body and spirit to twist fate against the relentless pull of time, only to break the surface in a moment of anticipation and culmination, and then emerge back into the light, awash in reflection and satisfaction of a life well lived. Like no other, Dr. Sammy Lee soared. While divers rely on perfect form and control to ensure light entry into water, Sammy Lee made a dramatic splash in every endeavor for nearly a century. Into everything he did, he infused his sport's ideal of a vertical body, standing taller than most men and never bending to hardship or prejudice. And by securing an enduring place in sports, medicine, and civil rights, this beloved Trojan also ensured a permanent place in our hearts, thoughts, and memories. Nearly 4 years ago, a new dive tower at the USC Utengsu Aquatic Center was named after Sammy, and there could not be a more appropriately designated place on our campus. It calls on anyone who sees it to aspire to his great heights and never be daunted by what awaits below. It also transports us back nearly 70 years to a time when Sammy attended our medical school. He came to learn how to heal others, but the childhood dream burned deeply within him to become an Olympic champion. At USC, he would dive at lunchtime and at night. In those moments of personal reflection, Sammy no doubt thought of how far he had come and how far he would go. From the 1932 LA Olympics that sparked his athletic hopes as a child, and how destiny partnered him with diving that same summer, to the racial discrimination of that era that would limit a Korean boy's time in public pools. Intolerance often added several degrees of difficulty to fulfilling his ambitions throughout life. And when it appeared in the form of housing discrimination, after Sammy had claimed Olympic gold, his defiance rallied national support. He would later declare, "My belief in the American people is substantiated." Perhaps nothing better reveals the heart of a champion more than when his faith in himself is matched by that he has in those around him. This faith, coupled with expertise and gratitude for those who had mentored him, shaped his life in profound ways. It led a successful career as a diving coach for many other Olympians who followed his steps from the platform to the podium. It also drove him to champion his alma mater, from establishing the USC Korean Heritage Library to supporting our Keck School of Medicine. So, Rosalind, Pamela, and Sammy II, while many remember your father for augmenting USC's legendary Olympic heritage, he achieved much more. He was also legendary in how he enriched countless lives. He inspired us to dream bigger and showed us how to be the best for ourselves and for each other. Through this and so much more, he ultimately substantiated our belief in him. He will forever missed. He will forever be a Trojan legend. Thank you.
I'm so pleased and humbled, too. In some small way, honored the life of this wonderful, unique, exceptional human being. What I would like to do is to share with you today a glimpse of Sammy in his formative years growing up in Highland Park and attending Franklin High School in the late 30s. These are the humble beginnings of which Sammy rose, was proud, and never forgot. We started gathering as a group in the mid-70s. This is a Sammy name. We're called the Farts. Salty. And now it's an acronym of endearment, but also reflective of the crusty, good-natured, curmudgeon Sammy in us Franklin Panthers were becoming. Plans are currently underway by the high school to identify ways to more permanently honor Sammy. In fact, the word on the street is the football and track stadium will probably be renamed Sammy Lee Stadium, possibly this April. Once a Panther, always a Panther. Today, we celebrate the greatest Panther of them all, Sammy Lee, a hero and inspiration to all of us, but especially to future generations. Again, I am so honored to be here today and thank the Lee family for this privilege, and especially recognize Roz for her graciousness, love, and devotion to Sammy over their 70 years together. Thank you and bless you all.
When I was 14, I went to the Coliseum and I was always watching Sammy Lee. And he was doing a flying 1.5. And I thought to myself, my friendship with this wonderful man will always be so, so special. And I will hold my memories close to my heart. We all love this guy. And that's all I got to say.
Sammy was a legend. He was not only a legend in diving, but his legend transcended many areas of sport, as well as his being known as a fantastic coach, of course, his medical career. But I think most important to diving was that he was a fantastic mentor. I told you that I traveled many places in the world with Sam. One of the most important times was in the late 90s. I was in Perth, Australia at the World Championship, and I shared a room with Sam. And we talked about everything for a couple of days, and after a couple of days, he said, "Tom, you know, I'm getting to really dislike you." And I thought, "Sam, why?" And he said, "Well, you're just about 20 years younger than me, and you've been talking about your grandchildren the whole time." And he said, "My children haven't blessed me with grandchildren yet." And he said, "I won't be complete until I have grandchildren." And I said, "Well, you better have a serious talk with them." And you know, a couple years later, they came through. Because I no longer had to receive Christmas letters that talked about grand dogs. And, that was really a great trip, but probably one of the highlights of my entire diving travels was when I was given the honor of escorting Roz and Sam back to London in 2012, the site of Sam's first Olympic gold medal. I had never seen a man so loved and admired. Every time we went into the pool, they would grab him and run him out for an interview with this huge jumbotron with 15,000 people there to listen to Sammy Lee. And we couldn't even get home at night. We would take a train to our apartment that we shared, and people on the train got so excited about talking to Sammy Lee, they passed up their own stop, like 2 or 3 miles. And when I got off, I said, how are you gonna get back? And they said, well, we'll have to walk. There's, you know, that's the last train. And they said, but it was worth it. You know? And it was a wonderful time for me, and I hope it was wonderful for Roz and Sammy. Sammy was truly a legend in the diving world. I listened to John do all the introductions and I realized I knew every one of those stories and I could go around the world and people could quote all of Sammy's history. But before I leave the stage, I want to say one thing. Sammy spent a lot of time traveling around the world and being a wonderful mentor and hero to the diving world. And I realized that took a lot of time away from his family. So I want to sincerely thank Roz, Pam, and Sam for sharing all those times with our hero.
Doctor, he was the smartest and funniest person I ever met, except when I met him at the diving pool. I came to America to become Doctor Lee's diver. On the first day of the training, I met him at Mission Viejo diving pool. Each time I dove and came out of the pool, I heard Doctor Lee say, God damn it, John. I didn't speak English, so I didn't understand what he's saying. I just assumed that's where he called my name. Since I heard so often, I asked other divers, what does God damn it mean? And why Dr. Lee keeps saying it? They all told me, don't worry about it. Dr. Lee still loves you, and that's why he's saying it. I eventually found out what it really meant. He wasn't calling my name at all. He just didn't like the way I was diving. So God damn it, John became my nickname at the pool. Dr. Lee was a very tough coach. But outside of the pool, he was my mentor and friend who can give all kinds of good advice about life. And I miss him very much.
I'm honored to be here on behalf of the Salada and Fitch and many other families to speak about fun things about Sammy. Sammy had the most ferocious sweet tooth that was really second to none. We went to the Rose Bowl luncheon before SC played Penn State last time, not this year. And they, at the luncheon the day before, they had these solid footballs as the dessert, kind of like these party favors on all the tables. And Sammy's like, hey, do you think they're gonna eat theirs? Do you think they're gonna eat theirs? And Trader Joe's was one of the sponsors, so we got an SC Trader Joe's bag, and he goes, Melanie, go see if everyone's gonna eat their chocolates, you know? And then, so he has me like a hunter-gatherer. We had, by the end of the luncheon, I had three bags, Trader Joe's bags of these chocolate footballs. They're big. And he's like, all right, this is the greatest day ever. Anyway, Sammy could get away with murder with that little smile. He was like, ah, you know, I'm carrying his bags with the footballs. I'd drive Sammy and Roz to the home games for USC, and I'd always have hot chocolate and candy bars in the car. Because after the game, he'd go, okay, hit me with a little hot chocolate. And I need to, you know, my husband's asleep in the back and Sammy's yupping it up eating the candy bars. So he's really endless. About his speaking career, he used to say, I should have been a proctologist, not an ENT, because all I see are belt buckles and asses. So when he'd come up to the podium with my dad, it's a visual, sorry, President McKeas. So when Sammy would come to speak at the podium with my dad would pull up a chair and Sammy would get on this chair and speak from the chair. And one banquet, my dad even got on a chair next to Sammy, and they were like the two guys on the chairs telling jokes. But when Sammy got older, we were concerned that he would fall off the chair. And so we'd have these guys, we called them catchers, and they'd be back in case Sammy fell off the chair, which he never did. And someone said, actually, Tom DeLong said, if Sammy ever fell off a chair, he'd do it in pike position with a 1.5 twig, you know, and he'd say, he looked like this, so he never fell. But it was fun. He talked to elementary schools. They called him the koala bear. Everybody wanted to hug Sammy. He said, I'll be over here with the fourth graders. They're about my size. And we're like, okay, don't tell any dirty jokes, okay, Sammy? He's like, okay. Anyway, nobody could tell a joke like Sammy Lee and get away with it. If you remember the Al Davis joke, the Bangkok joke, people would look the other way and just say, did he really say that? And Roz would sit there poised and smiling, and Roz was practiced doing, behind every great man is a great woman. My dad says, you're behind Sammy because you're the only one small enough that would fit behind Sammy. But really, Roz is perfect. She's a Jacqueline Kennedy of JFK. She was Sammy's rose next to the thorn. She was the call to Bogey, the ginger to Fred. Thank you, Roz, for always being there for Sammy. Let's celebrate life for another 96 years. Fight on.
Well, going back to if Sammy had fallen off that chair, he would have been asking what his scores were. Some people come into our lives, leave a footprint on our souls, and we're never the same. Sammy was that person for me. He took a so-so high school diver under his wing and made Olympic champion. He gave me the greatest gift, and that was to believe in myself. One quick story I want to tell about Sammy that's stayed with me forever, and that was when he and Roz were first living in, they were still living in Garden Grove. It was very early when I started training with him. And in his backyard, he had built a diving board with a sand pit. And the sand pit, you fluff it up, make sure the cats haven't visited the night before. But you fluff it up, and so it's about the level of the diving board, and you do somersaults to your feet, et cetera, et cetera. And he told me this one story about his coach, what he had done with Sammy. Sammy was doing back somersaults, okay, and he was landing in the sand pit, but it was 2 or 3 feet off to the side. And he kept doing that. His coach got a little bit ticked off at him, said, come on, Sammy. So what his coach did, he took a pitchfork, sawed the handle of the pitchfork off, put the prongs of the pitchfork face up where he had been landing. Said, Sammy, go do it. He straddled the pitchfork. When he told me that story, I knew right away that I better not go off to the side of the diving board, but also that I'd realize, you know, how dedicated and how tough he was. You know, as we know, Sammy was an all-in kind of guy. He'd been all-in as a diver. He was all-in as a coach for me, and he expected me to be all-in. And that was another gift. If you're going to tackle a situation, if you're going to tackle a challenge, do it all the way, go all in. And as we've heard today, Sammy's been all in many, many things that he's done in his life. He's a treasure. He was a treasure. He will be missed, and he'll never be replaced. God bless you, Sammy.
So as many of you already know, my grandpa was always a jokester and a teenager on the inside of him his whole life. So one of those experiences was when he came up for Christmas when I was around 8 years old. Grandma and Grandpa came up to our house, and Christmas morning we opened presents. That day, Santa brought me a brand new yellow Caterpillar bike with training wheels. It was amazing, and I guess my grandpa thought the exact same thing. He asked me that morning, Sam, can I go outside with you and watch you ride the bike? And so I said, sure. No way an 86-year-old man would want to go out in the cold and ride with me. I was sorely mistaken. He was the first one on the bike. So, as you can see, my grandpa always loved to have a great time and spend time with his grandkids. Aside from being an advocate for fun, my grandpa was also the hardest worker, and he always set his goals. All the stories of him overcoming his obstacles and making it to the Olympics and further in his life have really inspired me to do my best in both school and my own swimming career. Grandpa, you introduced me to USC by having me watch their football games, swearing at them, not me personally, and gifting me clothes all the time. And since then, I have tried to wear something from USC every day to honor your passion for the Trojans and the memory of you. I will always remember you as my grandpa and how you loved and cared for each one of us, myself, Alexander, and Samantha. Your hard work will continue to inspire me to keep working and fulfill your dream of me attending USC or Occidental College. Thank you.
My grandpa has been a huge part of my life, and I miss him every day. But his passing had made me remember the good memories I cherished with him. He truly showed that he would do anything for his grandchildren. For example, when I was about 5 years old, he bought knee pads just so he can play around with me on the ground. Even with his back pain, he wanted to spend as much time with me as possible. And every holiday or birthday, he gave me some type of USC clothing to share our love for the Trojans. I'll also never forget going to his induction into the Occidental Hall of Fame at Jack Kemp Stadium, or attending his ceremony at the opening of USC's diving tower in honor of his name and achievements. My grandpa made me understand the value of an education and how important it is to work hard every day to get one step closer to my dreams. Grandpa, you introduced me to ice cream at such a young age, and I've been eating it ever since. I thank you so much for that. Thank you.
My grandpa was a loving person who never gave up and who believed in others. He believed in me, and he believed I could be anything I wanted to be by work hard. Just like him, he wanted to be a diver and a doctor, and he had to work hard in school. My parents always say to me that I'm like my grandpa. I had to work hard, extra hard in school, just like him. I remember one time he gave me this USC cheerleading outfit with USC pom-poms. I would run around the house cheering, fight on. I remember I would always play hide and seek with him, and I would always hide in one spot, and he would always find me. I remember I would always give him haircuts with these plastic scissors, and I always liked to touch his hair. We had so many great memories together. My parents always say to me, just like you did, yeah. He would always come to my dance competitions to cheer me on, and he still is now. He would always say, I'm so proud of you, princess. Keep on dancing, it will harden up. I say that to myself every time I'm backstage and about to go on, because that makes my confidence boost up, and it makes me happier to go on stage. He always says that you should always be what you want to be and never give up on it. I'm so lucky to be named his granddaughter. He always says that his three grandchildren are his three Olympic medals. Looking back at his life, I'm so inspired and amazed by him, and he has had a great life and legacy. I'm so amazed by him, and he motivates me every day to work harder. I'm going to continue to make him proud, and I will strive to get accepted into the USC Gloria Kaufman School of Dance. Thank you.
Growing up, people asked why I wasn't a diver. And really, there's three things. One, I really didn't have the athletic desire to be a diver. Two, at my house, we used to grow bamboo. And my dad used to make the divers cut the bamboo, trim the bamboo, and then he would hit them with the bamboo when they didn't do that right. And three, divers wear Speedos. There's a lot of you in this room that should never be seen in a Speedo. And that includes myself. Real quick, on a short list of divers that I always saw float through the house, Bobby Webster, who spoke here, was quite frankly an individual that he just happened to choose diving, but if he would have chosen any other sport, he would have excelled at it. Just an athletic individual. Peter Ickes was a family friend and a diver, and as a young boy, I always knew that you were in the TV industry, and I always just assumed that you were a soap actor, just a very good-looking guy who always spoke well. Billy Day, who's here, always got hit with the bamboo a lot. But Billy Day never, ever wasn't smiling to this day. If you meet Billy Day today, he is always smiling. Jung Kim, who spoke here, he was the toughest kid my dad ever met. Typical tough Korean, and also a typical Trojan. Hong Ping Lee came a long way from China. As a skinny kid who used to drive a car that my dad gave him, a little red piece of junk that he drove to and from the diving workouts, I've come a long way to be the coach of the USC Trojans. Greg Louganis, like Michael Jordan or Kobe, he was an athlete that truly was meant to be a diver. And as we have all seen, he was a wonder to watch. My father grew up very close to where we are currently. My dad was raised to be a proud and strong Korean American. Dad grew up in a time when, shall we say, it was less opportunistic for individuals of color. But my dad felt that two areas were colorblind and equalizers. One was sports, and two was education. Occidental College. Why did my dad choose Oxy? Was it because he wanted a liberal arts education that would give him the tools to enter medical school? Yes, it was. But two, my dad chose Oxy because Oxy had given his father, my granddad, and his older sister the opportunity to attend Occidental College. Especially for my grandfather, Oxy gave our family the opportunity for education during a time when opportunities were limited. As a side note, my father met my mother at Taylor Pool at Occidental College. Oxy has been a home for my sister as well as for myself. I graduated in 82. My sister attended Oxy, USC, became a pharmacist at UOP, and then unfortunately she got her MBA at UCLA. We would like to thank the Vice President and Director of Athletics for Occidental College, Jamie Hoffman, for being here today. The University of Southern California gave my father the tools and skills to be a respected physician. Also, it opened the doors for him because he was a Trojan. I really never knew the meaning or fight on until the later years of my dad's life. Thank you to the USC family for getting my dad to USC football games and Cardinal Gold events. Almost every function my dad and mom attend had a USC connection. Thank you, President Nikias, for having us here and for leading the Trojan family. If you all want to be humbled, you might want to look at his resume and see that man's accomplishments. Dr. Lee, my dad, had numerous accomplishments. Physician, leader and pioneer for Asian Americans, Olympian, but for me and my family, it was being a grandfather. He was active with his grandchildren and stressed the importance of education. All three grandchildren, as you can tell, have USC and Occidental on the top of their radar list. The last conversation my son, Alexander, who was a senior in high school, had with my father was he asked my dad if he had done enough to gain acceptance to Occidental College and USC, which school should he pick? Well, I won't share with you what he told my son, but I will tell you, he looked at my son and said, "God damn it, just don't be a Bruin." Right on.
My best memories are simple ones that, from just getting time spending with Dad, we'd be making root beer floats from our soda fountain after he was finished coaching with the kids in our backyard. We'd go to his office where he always had a box of See's candy in his desk. As Mel mentioned, he loved sweets. And getting popsicles at the hospital when he was making rounds, I'd get to go on rounds with him. We'd also get to drive around in his 1964 Aston Martin, like the one in James Bond, Goldfinger. And people would ask if he was odd job. And that was because he was A, Asian, and B, he also had that big round head, just like Oddjob. Dad always said if he had a body that corresponded with the size of his head, he could have been a football player. Football was always a big part of our lives growing up. We'd watch football on TV, and many times we'd have two TVs going on at once. He'd be cussing at both of them simultaneously. In fact, when we were at the Rose Bowl a few weeks ago watching that game, I could hear him yelling and screaming at his Trojans' lame performance during the third quarter and against Penn State, and then hearing him cheer at that last second field goal. He had a rich 96 years, and I would like to acknowledge the doctors who contributed to keeping Dad in his game and looking at the right side of the grass, as he always said. Dr. Ki-Hong Kwan, who performed his bypass, and brought his entire surgical team to a hospital closer to Mom so that she did not have to drive so far. Dr. Ben Rubin, Dr. Jerry Cantor, and Dr. Martin Bay. I would also like to express my appreciation to my cousin Debbie for her assistance here in coordinating and organizing our reception at USC. Her husband Ben for helping Dad through all those games at USC, going to the bathroom. I think he missed probably a season's worth of football games. My cousin Karen for the beautiful floral arrangements, and my sister-in-law Gina for capturing these moments on camera. Thank you to the communities from Franklin High School, Occidental College, USC, the Army, the Olympics, the medical community, and neighbors for the long friendships that you've afforded him through his life. Everyone knows that Dad was able to live his long life because of Mom and accomplish so much because of Mom. Dad used to say he married her because he had a cook-off to decide who to marry, and my mom was the winner. Mom did everything for Dad. Throughout their 66 years of marriage, they experienced an incredible life together, enriched by so many friends from around the world. Dad loved his family, and he always said his greatest accomplishments were not Olympic medals, but his living gold medals, my brother and I. Once we were older, Dad used to whine that he would only get grand dogs and that he would be in diapers before he got to see grandkids in them. We are grateful that was not the case, and he was able to see his greatest passions grow up into their teens. Me and Wesley's son, Sam, and my brother and Gina's children, Alexander and Samantha. Yes, he was a doctor, he was an Olympian, he achieved many significant firsts, but to us, he was just our beloved dad. Thank you, everyone, for coming to celebrate him.